afternoon, everyone. It is a pleasure to have you back. The semester here in Foscari is about to start, probably, you know, has started already somewhere else in some other institutions. So, and then we are resuming this usual activities of having a nearly weekly seminar of the series of the ECLT network. We hear from the ECLT network. So today we have a pleasure to have Luca Bonatti with us. You know, we have been chasing him for a while, so you know, we are happy to have him back. So Luca, you know, graduated, you know, started his brilliant career by graduating in philosophy at the University of Milan, and then he moved to Rutgers for his PhD. Then he went to Paris to study cognitive science when he learned that he got acquainted with some experimental features. And then he entered in the University of Paris 8, Paris 8, as an associate professor. Then he moved to CISA. You know, he spent some time in CISA when he met Matthew Diamond. And then he eventually got a professorship at the University of Pompeu Fabra as ICREA professor, as well as at Foscari as full professors. So he has many affiliations. He has three affiliations: University of Foscari, ICREA, Pompeu Fabra, and ECLT. So, you know, we hope, we are very happy about this. So he's an expert of logical process in infant mind, which is actually the topic of his talk. So we look forward to his talk. Luca, please, the floor is yours. Thank you for having accepted our invitation.
Thank you very much for this introduction. Okay, so let me share my screen and go for the presentation. I guess you should see it now. And of course, please feel free to just interrupt me anytime you want. Okay, so this is a collaborative work which have been obtained thanks to the sweat of many people. The yellow ones here are the three main persons who contributed to the kind of work that I'm presenting today. There are many others that really did a lot of important contributions. So let me just tell you what I'm interested in really, which is not what I do. What I'm interested is to find out why humans, since the early moment of that we can trace, came up with this kind of incredibly elaborated pictures and representations. This is one of them, you know them for sure, but there are many other kinds of signs of the inventiveness of humankind, some of which we know because we are using them now, some of which we disregard very often, like the faucet, for example, things like that. So if you look at around your environment now, there is a bet, there is not a single thing that you can see which is not a product that touched in some way some solution invented by humans. And this tells our species apart from all the others. I mean, I'm very much for continuity, but I think it would be like deceiving ourselves if we didn't consider the important part that culture, human culture, and human problem solving have given to the construction of the world. So there is this incredibly creative pressure in the human mind, and we see it all over the places. And the question is where it comes from. How come we have this ability? Of course, I'm not able to solve this, but that's really my motivation. And one of the little parts of my previous philosophical life which remain has to do with this fact that we are able to solve an incredible amount of problems. There is a huge amount of material culture, and we can do it because we can think about problems. And so the question that is really important to figure out is what is thinking. And I'm not going to solve that question either. So, but let me just give you the background. One part of this talk is to give you the background and the motivation of what I'm trying to do. So to think something, we need to represent some states of affairs. These states of affairs must be true or false. we can believe them, we can wish them. So there is some sort of propositional content such that we can express sentences like I believe that, or I would like to have that P, okay? And these representations are not just, as it were, a mishy-mashy kind of thing. They're completely structured to the unfortunate discovery of some John. John loves Mary is not the same thing as Mary loves John. It's very important that these enter in a structured relations and that they express different propositional content according to how this relation is organized internally. There is a point which is important for me is that this representation, these kind of building blocks of reasoning, are also connected by some sort of logical relations. Let me just give you some examples. Again, I'm not going to talk about them, but I want to give you the measure of the complexity of the problem. So we can say something like John eats pizza with pepperoni, and we know by understanding the sentence that John eats pizza. However, if we just simply put a negation, the same thing doesn't happen. John doesn't eat pizza with pepperoni doesn't imply that John doesn't eat pizza. He could be eating another pizza. Indeed, we know that at least it implies that John doesn't eat pizza with pepperoni and mushrooms. So there are ways in which you can draw inferences from a set to its superset or to its subset, which are very systematic given the meaning of a sentence. And the same thing happens with what we are more used to treat, like, for example, connectives and quantifiers, like John likes Mary or car, John doesn't like Mary, therefore John likes car, which is going to be basically the only real topic of my talk today. Okay. Now, these relations of logical relations among sentences in language are so important that they also appear into the grammar. And this is a point that has been made very forcibly by Gennaro Chierchia, who is also a collaborator or part of this work. And let me give you again an idea that will maybe hit especially the English speaking, the English mother tongue people here. So I can say to you, I don't like this talk at all, okay? But I cannot say I like this talk at all. This is badly formed, right? Or I can say, I like it a little, but I cannot say, I don't like it a little. This seems like an odd behavior, but it's very systematic. Every languages have these expressions, which are called the negative polarity items, that license certain kind of inferences in a context and simply cannot appear in other contexts. Consider ever never. I never liked him. I can say that, but I cannot say I ever liked him. At the same time, though, if I take the same sentence that I cannot say, and if I embed it in a conditional, if I ever meet you again, I'll give you money, your money back, that appears again a good kind of sentence. Okay, so there are a lot of these kind of words, quantifiers, connectives, that are allowed or not allowed according to their meaning, but according also to their composition. And therefore, they can appear in negative context, they cannot appear in other contexts, they can appear in implication context, but they cannot appear in disjunction context. So the question here is, how come, where does this incredible web of logical relations come from? Is it only, as it were, a feature of a natural language, or is it a feature of the mind? So the idea there that I'm trying to propose is that there are part of this that really depend on how our mind is set up. So we go back to the question, how do we think? And here, there was this answer that was given a long time ago by Jerry Fodor. And the answer is, well, we think in a language, which is a language of thought. And the very main argument that Jerry Fodor gave is the following. If when we learn, we test hypotheses, then it's necessary that we have to possess the representational resources by which these hypotheses can be formulated, okay? So I'm focusing now on this antecedent of the argument. The antecedent being is learning implies testing hypotheses. And of course, there are many kinds of learning that don't imply testing hypotheses, including, for example, statistical learning, right? It's somewhat a bottom-up complete system. But the question is there only this kind of learning in humans? And what I want to show you first by referring to work that has been done in other kinds of laboratories. Let me just see. Okay, inference do test hypotheses, and they do have a very structured way of thinking. So let me just refer to, there are many kinds of streams of literature. I only want to focus on one for the interest of time, and it is work that comes from the laboratory of Lisa Feigenson and John Hopkins, and she did an incredible amount of beautiful work. And what she did is the following thing. She presented kinds of situations to infants, if we're talking about 12 months old infants, like this one, or else like this one, where infants are told something about the device that they're seeing. And then at a certain point,
look at this, watch this.
There is an event that violates some expectations if infants have an expectation, for example, that objects have to fall, as in the previous example, or that objects are solid that cannot be penetrated with the other. We know since like 20, 40 years by now that infants are indeed surprised when they see violations of physical phenomena. And they are surprised starting from probably 3 months. So it's not like there is much time to develop this kind of expectations. That was known. So what Lisa Feigenson did was a very simple thing, which is, okay, now I give you these toys. So she was not interested in whether infants were surprised. She was assuming that infants indeed were surprised. The question is, what do they do with this surprise? So this is an example of what she did. She gave the toys that were the infants had just seen to undergo a violation of expectation of their expectations, and she just traced how much, for example, they bang a toy or how much they drop a toy according to whether they have seen a violation of solidity or a violation of support, like the two things that I showed you before. And what she showed very beautifully is that infants who just saw a violation of solidity, they tend to bang the object that they are given more, with respect to infants who were shown a violation of support. By contrast, the exact opposite behavior occurred in infants who saw a violation of support. This kind of result suggests that infants do see a situation, they make expectations, and especially that when the expectations are violated, they start testing hypotheses about the violation. So I think that antecedent of the argument of Fodor can be actually granted. So infants do make hypotheses about unexpected events, they test causes of failure, they explore rational alternatives, so we can check these. And now the question is, what can we say about the consequence of this argument? What are the representational resources that allow infants to formulate these hypotheses? What's the role of logic in it? Okay, and so this kind of reasoning, this kind of argument has been living in the literature, philosophical literature, until recently. But recently, there is a lot of work that has assumed an hypothesis of the assuming language of thought. So let me just mention work that you might have seen. Josh Tenenbaum and his group has worked a lot to specify a language of thought with probabilistic elements that have been used to explain phenomena in work learning, conceptual change, and so on. Stanislas Dehaene has done incredibly beautiful work recently to take domain-specific kinds of situation, like, for example, geometry reasoning, and show that you can actually specify primitives of this language of thought, and you can predict what a mind can do by, for example, composing new figures and so on the basis of these primitives. Or there is recent work on even the neurological basis of language of thought, which has been done at Harvard and Princeton by Joshua Green and Steve Franklin. Okay, so there is this body of literature that seems to validate this old idea, but we know nothing about what infants do. Okay, so that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to gather evidence that even in infants, there are some basis of reasoning that are not essentially driven out by experience, but they allow infants to make sense of the experience and therefore to learn. So I'm trying to look for primitives of thoughts, ways of combining them, ways to show that infants use these primitives to predict the future, therefore to reason about, to reason and therefore to make hypotheses. Okay, and I've been trying to do it by with my collaborators by studying some of the abilities that infants seem to deploy when they reason probabilistically, where probability, we can discuss about that, has nothing to do with the experience or very little to do with experience, and more recently on logical reasoning. How did I do it? Well, we did it by taking a very terrible approach, with, which cost a lot of work and years to get results. And the idea is extremely naive. It's very naive. It's wrong. But that's the way we started. And it's the following. Take any kind of logical system, very elementary logical systems. You are going to find rules like instantiations, elimination of alternatives, or modus ponens. And those structures have always two points in common. They require that you can express something in some logical language. So you need to set up a logical representation. And for this logical representation by a system, for example, of rule elimination, you draw inferences. So what we have been trying to do is to find ways in which we focus on what kind of logical representations infants can create and what kind of inferential processes infants can deploy. And to do that, we focused on one single case, the case of disjunction and the elimination of disjunction, and that's what I'm going to talk today. And the idea is, let's try to find ways in which we can represent this kind of reasoning without language. Transform this kind of pattern in something that can be contained in a scene, because of course, working with the infants, we cannot speak to them. And then let's find behavioral or more recently neural markers that seem to suggest that at certain moments, infants make a representation, and at certain moments, infants make an inference. And then the long-term plan is to find out how from these very basic facts, I hope that we try to establish this very rich web of inferences that I showed you before in language are finally achieved. So our basic strategy has been the following. We created this different scenes that involve different objects, but these objects as all, these are in couples in this kind of experiments, but they all have something in common. If you look at them only partially, if you look only at the top part of them, they are identical. Therefore, in certain situations, you cannot distinguish one from the other. We embedded these couples in very elementary scenes that somewhat capture the fact that at a certain moment you make a logical representation and at another moment you can make an inference. So that's the idea. For the logical representation part, I don't know if you can see these little movies. I hope you can. So if you look at this very small fragment, you start with two objects, and then there is a moment in which one object is scooped by a cup, and therefore now you cannot know what object is inside the cup. It could be either one or the other. And you can contrast this with situations in which you know it. So finally, you're going to see the same thing, but now you have been given information about the identity of this object. So in this, by comparing these scenes, we can find out whether there is a difference between the representation of an unknown or an X in logical language, or a disjunction, we still don't know, versus the representation of a constant. So variable versus constant, for example, okay? Now the scene continue, and it can continue in different ways. One is this one. There is a little object that comes out from it. So if you had made an hypothesis about it being, there being two objects, and you don't know the identity of these objects, but in this very moment, you see an object coming out, then this information is sufficient for you, if you draw an inference, to determine the identity of the object in the cup, even if you never see it, okay? And so this is a possibility. Another possibility is this one. The object does come out from this occluder, but you see that there is this grass that grows, but it comes out from behind. So you are obliged to maintain the representation of an unknown object, okay? So in this way, we can compare what happens when, so if you have seen this situation from which you couldn't determine the identity of this object, then this information is important for you. But if you were coming from a situation in which you knew the identity of this object because you had seen it jumping it into it, then this information is useless for you. At the same time, if you maintain information here about the unknown nature of this object, then you cannot solve this information here. So you are obliged to keep ahead the kind of representation that you had before. So we can compare a moment in which there is a logical representation in which we can compare an inference versus, sorry, an unknown versus known, and the moment in which, according to what you have seen, we can figure out what happens if you have the logical elements to make an elementary inference, or when you don't need to make an inference, or whether you cannot make an inference because there is not enough information in the scene such that you can derive an inference. So that's the basic idea. The idea is very elementary scenes that could represent a very simple logical reasoning. And what we have been trying to do is to study behavioral and neural markers that seem to suggest that adults and infants do something in the moment in which they see the situation. So let me just go back to the first part, the first of the logical representation. What I present today are data that come from pupil dilation. And in particular, we're interested in tracing the dynamics across time of how a pupil, which has been considered to be a good sign for cognitive effort, evolves. And as you can see here I'm comparing the situation I call the known condition, situations in which adults know what object is in the cup with respect to the unknown condition, situation in which they have no idea, they need to keep something in their memory. You can see that right after the presentation of the part of the scene, the pupil remains more dilated in the unknown than in the known condition. And this happens in adults, but even if we take 12 months old and we tested also 19 months old, we find exactly the same profile. Infants seems to do, and these are situations that last like 1 second, 1 second and a half, and infants have no task. There is no surprise. There is nothing there. They could be sleeping for what we know, yet they process the information that they're seeing, they try to make sense of the scene, and they do something different in the moment in which they know the identity of an object, or in the moment in which they have to maintain an unknown representation in their memory. Now we go to the moment of the inference, when the information could allow somebody to disambiguate the identity of the object in the cup. And once again, in this very little moment in which there is a little object that comes out from behind the occluder, or you know, according to whether you know or you don't know what was in the cup. When you don't know what the object was in the cup, your pupil remains dilated more with respect to situations in which there is no need for any inference. And the same thing occurs at 12 months. Infants in these situations have a higher pupil dilation when they can derive an inference with respect to when they need not derive any inference. With adults, that's what we could do with infants. With adults, we can even go finer. We can compare situations in which you can make an inference, or what we call the lack of inference, situations in which you cannot make an inference because the object was coming out from the occluder from behind the grass, right? And we can show that inference is more costly than maintaining the logical representation, but at the same time, maintaining the logical representation is more costly than not needing any logical representation at all, because you know the identity of the object. So we can say something quite fine in a quite detailed way across an extremely simple passive view of the situation.
Sorry, Luca, I have a question. How do you monitor in the sense that, you know, as the time passes, so the children are acting. This is how you monitor this plot as a function of time.
We have an eye tracker. We present these movies. We control very. We know very well when infants are looking and they are not looking. In as a matter of fact, the presentation of the movies is infant control. So if infants turn away, we stop the movie. When infants go back to the screen, the movie starts again. Right. And we do nothing else. So infants are really free to do whatever they want. In fact, this is a boring experiment. It's not like, it's not the best. That's what was painful. You require a lot of kids because some of the kids really don't want to stay. But What is very surprising is that those kids who actually are watching the situation, they have this physiological reaction. So that's what we do. This is an eye tracker, and these are data from an eye tracker. Is that answer?
Yes, thank you. That's very clear now.
Okay.
Luca, this is Matthew. Just a technical detail, actually, that came from your reply just now. There can be a discontinuity in the movie if the baby looks away or the child looks away.
Yes,
because that's a bit curious, because that's as if you're asking them to understand that time can just stop and then start again. Isn't that in itself sort of illogical?
The number one thing is that there is a lot of evidence that infants are very sensitive to self-control of this movie. So not our movies, but many other stimuli. This is a procedure that many laboratories use, which is letting infants control completely the experiment. Now, these are scenes. So I understand what you're saying. And the point is, we looked at, we have, of course, criteria for stopping the trial. So if infants look away for more than 1.5 seconds, we stop the trial, and that is not considered. But if there are brief interruptions, like up to 1 second, 1 second and a half, then these interruptions are not a function of the condition in which infants are. Mm-hmm. So they scatter across all the conditions. And yet, we still get the result, namely when infants see the situation, which is entirely identical, but they need to make an inference, or they need to maintain a logical representation, they have higher pupil dilation. So it could be as it were slightly unnatural, but it doesn't account for the results, because it just affects all conditions. What then generally happens is that in most of the cases, infants, when they stay on the movie, they do stay on the movie. The point is that very often infants are sat on the caretakers, caregivers' laps. So very often they turn, for example, to watch if the caregivers watches and so on. So they don't interrupt looking at these movies because they don't care, but because they want to actually involve somebody else.
Yeah. It's very interesting, and it's I can't help but already, as you're talking, before we get to the final discussion, connect to the introduction about people learn things because they think, and what's kind of the hidden factor that seems to be in this experiment is that the 12 months, they want to know something. I mean, why do they? They're curious. They want knowledge. They want to understand something. Absolutely. And if they didn't want to understand, then they wouldn't do this at all.
Entirely. And you can go back to Aristotle, and what Aristotle was saying is that philosophy is coming from being marveled at something, being surprised, being curious. That's, you know, how do you interpret how we are made? And I think this is a very important part of the constitution of our mind, is that we want to solve problems to the point that we are willing to stay years and years in a laboratory. Mm-hmm. Why? Mm-hmm. Like, who cares? That's because we are obsessed by the fact that there is knowledge there and we want to capture it. And you can find it very, very early on.
Mm-hmm. Also early on, earlier in evolution, because not only humans want to know about the world, but also animals. I mean, it can be shown that they collect information even when they have no benefit, direct benefit, no material benefit. They actually just want to know about the world.
I entirely agree about that. Again, I am very much for continuity. Now, there is an empirical question, which is, okay, but can they actually draw this particular kind of information in these situations? Namely, do they have logical resources deployed in such a way that they can exploit the situation so quickly without any task, without any need to have food and so on and so on? That's an open question, but recent reviews of the literature on animals seem to suggest that they really don't do exactly the same thing that infants do. They don't get this information. They have a very particular strategy. For example, they look at things when they know that something is empty or something it contains something, but they don't seem to have these dynamics of doing something that suggests online processing of this information.
Hmm.
Yeah. So, and again, I'm very happy to just design an experiment to find it out. For the moment, I think this is the only kind of situation that works with adults, and there is no correspondent kind of work with infants with other species that I know of.
Well, I have a little comment, but I'll wait till the end about our rats.
Very well. Okay. Okay, so recently what we tried to do is to just find if we can describe the dynamics of the logical or the neural resources deployed when infants see these situations. And this is the first attempt we did. This has been done with Judith Gervin, who is now in Padova, as you know, so we hope to be able to continue this work between Padova and Venezia. And we use the FNIRS. FNIRS is a particular technique that doesn't allow a lot of temporal resolution, very precise temporal resolution. So what we were able to do is to monitor not the temporal course of this passage from making representations to drawing inferences, but the overall activation of the infant brain during whether when they were watching situations which had logical content or situation which had no logical content because everything was known to them. And we monitor particularly the frontotemporal areas for reasons that come from the literature of adults on verbal reasoning. Right? And these are the probes, and what this is somewhat the position of the probes. They are here to understand the relation between probes and channels. Imagine that this is the map, the picture that I'm showing somewhat is here, right? And what we found is a wide network of channels which was more active both in the left and in the right hemisphere, in the frontal and in the temporal channels, when infants were seeing the situation that had the logical content. So we cannot determine exactly what happens during these 10, 15 seconds of these scenes, but we can determine that the infants process them differently. I have to say that to keep infants watching, we modified the movies that I showed you in such a way that the most interesting and funny thing has nothing to do with this little moment. The movies continue, the objects do a lot of things and so on. So there is no reason for their brain to be more active in that particular moment, but to find out if they can determine the identity of an object or not, even if it has nothing to do with what really they like most. One other thing that I want to say is that this activation is bilateral. We didn't find any left hemisphere activation, whereas with adults, which is the data that I present you now, we did find that this activation is left centered. Okay, so this was we go back to the first moment of these scenes, this moment in which either you know or you don't know what object is inside the cup that you are seeing. And this was the data that I presented you before in the pupil. And now with adults, we could, by using fMRI, we could indeed trace the dynamics of the network. And what we found is that if we compare an unknown versus a known situation, we do find that the blue is essentially the known, there is a wide network which is active when adults are watching a scene in which there is a cup which hides an object whose identity they know. And this involves areas which have to do with vision, imagination, and areas which have to do with the language processing, probably because they know the identity of the object, so they say, oh, that's a snake, something like that. But when an object is unknown, the activation is much more focal. And in particular, we find a frontal area, which is inside the BA10, area, which is neither linguistic, nor imaginistic, nor memory. Well, this needs to be qualified, but somewhat is an area that seems to, which is not very well known, there are lots of discussion of what it does, but it does seem to code whether an object is unknown. Okay. Now we go to the moment in which there is potential information about the inference. This was the data that I showed you before. Therefore, when the resolution of the identity of the object can be done or need not be done because you know what object was inside the cup. And there too, we find that there is a different activity network which is involved when adults can draw an inference on when adults need not drawing an inference because they already know the identity of the object in the cup. Now, the important thing here is to compare what happens in the logical representation phase and in the inference phase. And I'm trying to describe it that way. Maybe you can see that there are some areas that are active during the moment of the logical representation when adults know what objects they are representing, although they don't see it. And these areas, they activate in the inference phase when the logical representation need not be drawn, and they become active in the inference condition. The very same areas has a dynamics, and here I present two of them, according to whether you can or you cannot, or you need not draw an inference across time. Why? Well, probably because in the moment in which you can, I show you an object and you know it's a snake, so you activate an area and say it's a snake. Now I don't show you that object, but you can determine that it's a snake by inference. At the end of this process, you are going to activate the same area, which is going to say, okay, it was a snake. And that's exactly what we see. Like we're seeing a dynamics of the brain areas which are involved in this extremely elementary logical reasoning that seems to suggest that really the brain is able to draw information which is not presented but can be derived logically, and that those areas essentially follow what the logical conclusion is and represent that logical conclusion. Okay, so okay, let me just take stock from for what I was saying. This is all what I wanted to present you in terms of data. The point is how to put together this into a more general picture. So I think that what we can show reasonably convincing, at least to my to my satisfaction, is that preverbal infants can spontaneously draw inferences when they passively see a scene, that these inferences have a particular logical content. We have just presented a single kind case that we studied in details. There are others. So we are really looking at a very, very small part of what the full set of reasoning consists of. I think we have identified some behavioral pupil dilation and others that I don't present here, and neural markers that put the finger on the moment in which an inferential activity can be drawn. To my knowledge, there is no work on nonverbal reasoning in adults. I mean, all the literature about adults and their ability to reason, I'm talking about neuroimaging literature, present verbal material. We were able to show that the network involved in the brain network involved in looking at this scene substantially overlaps with the very same network when you reason explicitly. But at the same time, there are parts of it which really specifically code something unknown with respect to something known. These markers are really stable. They are basically completely stable in terms of pupil dilation and almost stable in terms of logical processes, except that, as I mentioned before, perhaps the only difference that we found, which is substantial between between what we can show in infants and what we can show in adults, although the techniques are different, so these comparisons are really not precise, is that in infants, the activity of the brain when it's drawing an inference is bilateral, whereas in adults, it gets lateralized essentially in areas that partially overlap with linguistic areas. Now, we did that by only tracing an extremely simple pattern of reasoning, essentially because it's the simplest we could test. But a pattern of reasoning that does have the properties that that we wanted, that there is logical form, there are inferences. If these are represented, they are not linguistic. They must be in some sort of language of thought. But remember what I said before. Let me just mark it. This is the tip of the iceberg. Number one, because this is an extremely simple system of reasoning. There are many others, but especially because remember this web of connections of words that make some of the words licensed in a context, but not licensed in another, that makes some sentences involving inferences to the subset or inferences to the superset. How this is possible? What are the hard problems? The hard problem, besides the ones that we are trying to tackle now, are really to find out what are the primitives of a language of thought. We started with this extremely simple idea that or and not might be the primitives. That comes because of lack of imagination and because that's how a logical system, formal system, elementary system is set up. But we don't really know what are the logical primitives. And when we look at the semantic literature in language that explains why, for example, ever can occur in a positive context, but not in a negative context, we find that the primitives that semanticians use are different. So one point that they have to do more with set and set relations rather than with simple, with really directly logical forms. So one problem is really to find what are the proper primitives or language of thought that eventually will become our linguistic knowledge. And then how, what is a computationally plausible description of these primitives? We need to make a description that takes these primitives, proposed primitives, and shows that they have the properties that we know that exist in infants who have a very limited memory, a very limited ability to remember across time, right? And then the most important and most difficult thing for us is to find how this mapping between these primitive logical abilities and our linguistic system, which are extremely complex, occurs. What really infants learn? What is the status of their learning? There is a lot of literature that suggests that infants do not have this logical reasoning available until they learn language. Therefore, that logic is essentially piggybacking on the fact that language in itself has an incredible amount of structures that language makes available to the mind. Maybe the story is not this one. Maybe the story is infants have these logical abilities, but the complexity of mapping these logical abilities onto what we can express in language is really very much bigger than what we thought originally. And so we have a considerable amount of work to try to find out in the moment in which the very same logical set structures are presented to a child who is learning language, what kind of reasoning can he or she do linguistically, and what allows them to understand what parts of logical of a natural language carry the logical information that might be available to the mind prior to the mind having a language. So that's essentially the plan, the kind of work that we're doing, and the kinds of problem that I wanted to put on the table. That's what I wanted to say to you, and so, thank you for your attention. And if you have questions, I'm here. Oh, I see this beard. I know it.
Ciao. Ciao. I apologize that I was, first of all, in applause.
Virtual clap, you know, because.
I saw clap. Yeah, it's good. Good. Thank you.
Well, please, you know. Please,
can I go ahead?
Please, Alessandro, yes. That's a good question.
So I apologize that I had a meeting and I forgot that I connected only late. So I missed, over half of your talk. But
the left or the right part?
I missed the first, I think, 35 minutes. but let me still ask. So you call this logic. I think the data is very interesting, no? What you showed of neural data. But what I'm wondering about is in what sense the process of which you see the neural signature is a logical process or an inference, a logical inference. Because I can intuitively adopt these two terms, logical inference, and it's fine. It does not disturb me, but I wonder how strictly it describes this this thing that you test in the infants. Now, whether you could call it also other ways, you could call it associative inference, yeah, or associative mapping or something like that.
Well, this is a very, very deep question. And the answer is very big. Let me just tell you the state of the literature. Nobody is convinced that this is logical reasoning. And in fact, people have been trying to do models which show that if you only have, as it were, a very complicated object tracking system that does not require any inference, you can get essentially similar, at least behavioral reactions. Okay, so we can never know. If you look at the scene, that's a philosophical fact. It's an in-principle fact. You can never know what the description of this is in the brain. We can only argue by a very complex inferences to the best explanation. So we start with this idea that for me is, as it were, driving experiments and kinds of literature, namely that there is a very simple set of logical primitives, by meaning that you actually are representing at a certain moment that there is a distinction between a variable and a constant. So elements of a language, that variables can be bound, that they can be bound by operators that determine the set, which is the relevant set, and that these operators can be eliminated when I give you other information that can be represented by other logical forms. Okay, now what I could exclude, I think, unless you have I would tend to say that whichever story you have, the associative story is not going to help you in the least, right? Because what would you associate with what? I mean, obviously at a certain point, there is an association you need to do between representations and some other representations. But what is the mechanism driving these associations? What we have been trying to show is that if you know the identity of an object, you do, if you want to put it that way, the association in a different way with respect to when you don't know the identity of the object and you have to derive it by some other information. Mm-hmm. But from the point of view of what you see, you're essentially seeing the same things. So the question, there is a project that would be really nice, which is, okay, start with pixel description of these scenes. How much information can you derive without putting in some kind of inferential structure, right? We are trying to do that. To my surprise, I found out that even the representation of you can correct me here and then be happy to know, even the representation of an unknown object. I mean, there is a lot of object recognition literature in vision. But what does it mean to represent something that you don't, whose identity you don't know? That's not a problem that is really present in this literature, which is very much based on association, right? So there are really problems that need to be really disentangled, right? So I would tend to say I take the point that my description is very partial to what happens, and I can tell you it's a description that they call logical because it requires the presence of certain kind of typification of representation, variable versus constant, complex sentences versus simple sentences, and so on. If you think that are presented in sentences, it's logical because it also requires elimination, in this case, of an inference. That's my sense of logical. There are many other kinds of models that can be made. Of these models, I cannot picture, until I'm convinced by simulations, that a completely purely associative mind can get the same results. Because I don't know what you associate with what.
I would imagine, I don't know, just to continue, I kind of take your point, but just for the sake of it, I thought when you had the scheme that you could associate not A with B and B and not B with A.
Meaning that you represent object A, object B, object A to the left, object B to the right. Yeah. Okay.
But maybe I missed because
let me just get one slide, and maybe you haven't seen. But the question is the following: suppose that I show you. Okay, this is what I wanted. Suppose that I show you this. Okay, this very simple snippet. Okay. Okay, what do you associate with what? So I'll show it to you again. So you have two objects. Okay, and now you have something. You can think that this is a third object. You can think that this is one of the two. You can think that this is one of the two objects, and you can bet. So you say, for example, I bet it's the snake. Yeah?
Yeah.
We have a lot of work that you've done to show that this betting possibility is not there in data analysis. Right? So because the betting essentially predicts that when I give you the disambiguating information, half of the times you will be surprised and half of the times you won't be surprised. When you bet it right, you should be not surprised. And we don't find an index of bimodal distribution in the data. No? So what is what you associate with what? So in this situation, I suspect you can make an association of a position with the identity of the object. But in the unknown, what's the association story here? Yeah. And how do you explain that when then the scene continues in this way, you have processing, if you have seen this part before. So this way means that you have, because I don't know how much of this you can see via Zoom. Okay,
yeah.
See this one, okay?
Yeah.
Something happens if you come from here, nothing happens if you come from there. Mm-hmm. Not only that, but the neural circuit that is involved in what you do in this very moment is different according to whether you come from here or you come from there. So this is all, again, inference to the best explanation. So it's not that I can tell you, I can reject your story. But I think that the details are very important, and it's not sufficient to say, well, you know, I associate this with this, because it doesn't explain the pattern of the data. It's just empty as a statement in itself. It could be very substantially, and the way to do it is, okay, give me the best model, associative model, I run it on my data, and we are going to see whether how far it can explain what I find, or at what point it breaks down. That's part of what I would like to do, and it was part of why I think this network could be great for. Does it answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, good. So I mark today as a day in which I had a question such that Dr. Trevor said that it was answered. That's wrong.
Not the first time.
The first time, I would say. There is a hand on also, no? Maria.
Yeah, thank you. First of all, congratulations. I really enjoyed this presentation. Really fascinating topic, and also a completely new method, I would say. And also because personally, I love thinking about rational thinking and so on.
Rational thinking, like thinking in division, stuff like that.
Like yes, also the thinking behind, for example, mathematics, philosophy, yes, all of this. Of course, the problem of primitive or rational thought is some kind of really fascinating stuff. I would have just a curiosity. Because you performed your experiment with adults and children. So I'm wondering which result do you expect will be obtained if amongst children and adults, there will be some people with autism?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Well, let me tell you a little more that if even this is interesting again, and it addresses partly what Ale was saying, because there is another way in which you can talk about something being logical, and it has to do with the amount of abstraction that you can have in the representation. So if I show you that something works, quote unquote, logically, but only if I show you a snake and a ball, that's not particularly interesting. There is recent work that has been published in, I think it's Nature Communication, by my ex-student, Niccolò Cesana, who is also part of the work that I presented today, which showed that when infants, and we are talking of 12 months old infants, have to reason about somebody else's mental state, not about physical object, but about what you have in your mind, then they undergo the same kind of processes of elimination. So if they see a person who has a preference for an object, and they have to figure out what preference of which object on the basis of what they, what the infants know that the person who is looking knows, yeah? So passing through the other mind, they do the same kind of processes. Now, this could be a place where, for reasons that we know about autism and the ability to reason about theory of mind, we can have a breakdown. So perhaps the proper kind of pattern of responses that I would predict is that autistic children should be able to have this similar reactions to the one that we present, because they're extremely interested in the situation, what the world is made of. But they will probably break down when they have to take this system and abstract it out and apply it to other domains where they cannot. There is some possibility that we might be able to do something like that. As you know, this is very difficult to do according to the population. There might be a population in the Basque countries that we can use. We are thinking about that. I'm not an expert in autistic children, but that's a prediction. I don't know if that's a prediction that would satisfy you, or you had something deeper in mind, but I think we have predictions.
Yeah, no, it's really satisfying. I'm neither an expert on autism, just it happened to me to teach twice to autistic children, once teaching music and the other time teaching math. So it was really challenging, but also really rewarding as well.
Yeah. Thank you. The point is it challenging because they have different mental processes in terms of
completely. He had to enter within the world, especially for doing piano. So just like
enter. That is true, but what do you find in their words in terms of the logical ability? Let me give you an example. One of the reasons why we started this research is that everything we know about language has to do about reasoning, has to do with linguistics since Aristotle. Right, syllogism, right? Socrates, all the men are mortal, Socrates a man. Socrates. But we reason, when you sleep, you reason. And when you sleep, you see things which are extremely crazy. But think about your dreams, try to mark it down. Do you see things which are contradictory? Yeah. And the point has been made that that's not happens. So you see things like you can fly, you can do whatever you want, but there is a logic, a very precise logic in the way you dream. So the point is that this kind of reasoning is all over the place. You can change a lot of what you know about the world, but the kind of inferences that you draw, they seem to be simple. That is true also for pathologies like psychiatric pathologies. I mean, the typical case of somebody who believes that he's Napoleon, okay, but he reasons very well once you grant the premise, right? He organizes the
that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the question about autistic children is, of course, they have a world which is different from ours. But does that mean that they have basic primitives of logical reasoning which are different? Or does that mean that they have other hypotheses about what there is out there? That's a delicate question, and it's something that I'm not sure that they really reason in a different way in the sense in which we have defined reasoning here, which is extremely elementary.
That makes sense. It's like changing the starting axioms and then all the inferences of those ones.
That's the possibility. Yes.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you.
I guess that Matthew would like to make a comment.
The comment was not that interesting. When we were talking about curiosity, it was just
No, actually, what came to mind is why do you do things? And we're talking about whether people or animals do things when there's no material benefit. Once we had we train rats in the laboratories, you know, and once there was a student who had a rat that was very well trained in quite a difficult behavioral task, perceptual task, and discovered that that the reward system that gave the animal the reward on every trial was not working, and had not been working for the last 3 days because there had been a change in the software. But the rat had done the task with the same performance for 3 days, 300, 350 trials per day with no reward, just a clicking sound when he should have got the reward, but he didn't get the reward. So my point was that, which is maybe quite unrelated, but my point was that that not everything that an animal does is just to get a reward, material reward.
That's very interesting. I may tell you a little more. You know, there is this idea that the pressure for us evolving with bigger brains and so on is because essentially there was little food, we needed to find a way to survive and so on and so on. Of course, this is true. But there is work by Wieselbergi about, I don't remember what kind of monkey, because again, this I read, but I don't code. She went and studied different populations of monkeys who have a lot of problem solving themselves. And particularly one population was a population in which these monkeys had no problem surviving, because in fact they could only, you know, lift their hands and they would get food, right? Yeah. So according to the story that says only reward gives you, then you should predict that these monkeys should be really stupid. As a matter of fact, those monkeys were those who went and did the most advanced problem solving of the population of animals that she studied. So they were going around and finding ways to misplace big rocks that could have allowed them to break a nut that they wouldn't need to survive, because they were very, but it was fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that there is a method that people have studied, which is essentially starve the rat to 80% and then, you know, but that's the method.
Yeah.
It's not a condition.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And going back to sort of more to a technical level, I was lost the connection for 30 or 40 seconds. When I came back, you were showing some kind of imaging where you said that the representation of the snake was activated even if either by the word or by the logical inference of the snake. Yeah. I think you said that. Yes. So apologies if I missed some of the technical details, but my my question is sort of a neuro geek is, how do you know that was the representation of the snake? It was a very large, you know, a very large activation in the cortex. It could be a representation of anything. I think to say it's a snake, you'd have to have a situation in which different things could have been decoded, and to show that this is more like a snake representation than it's like a representation of something else.
Yes. So let me tell you, so this is the data that I was referring to. We have these two moments, what I call the logical representation, and we have this second moment, which I call the inference. And in the logical representation here, what you are looking are areas which are more active when adults know the identity of the object. Some of these areas have been associated to lexical processing, right? Because essentially, even if you don't know what there is in the cup, even if you don't see what there is in the cup, if you know it's a snake, you say it's a snake. Yeah. So you expect lexical areas active, and not only that, but you also see here that there are visual areas active because you probably envision the snake. Those very same areas, at the moment of the inference, become more active in the inference condition as opposed to the no inference condition. So the point here is what I was noticing is that there is a switch in some areas across time in these 2-3 seconds, or I mean a little more because of a technical question related to fMRI design, but between these two moments, the very same areas really do something different according to the condition. And one explanation is, if you see an object, so let me just stop sharing. So if you know what object is here, and you know it's a snake, that's okay. But if you go through a logical inference process, so you start from a state of knowledge which is lacking some information, then other information allows, finally you arrive to decide, okay, I know it's a snake. Thus, you contact some part of the system, the network that... So that was the sense in which I was saying that. And I entirely agree that this is speculation. I have to say that in the experience we did try decoding. And for us, that didn't work because we couldn't decode the objects to begin with. So we do have a decoding part of the experiment that we couldn't analyze because we did something wrong. But yes, the perfect experiment, then pending money we would do, is to really work more because we have predictions. In fact, the original experiment would have been to say, okay, now you see nothing here. But if you know by inference that that must be a snake, you have to have overlapping with the decoding of the snake when you see it. Because after all, when I say to you, look, be careful, it's a snake, or when you see the snake, or where you know it's a snake because of an inference, at the end, you get to the same mental state, right? Okay. So I entirely agree with you. And that's for the moment is the part that didn't work, but it was part of the design, yeah.
Okay. I have one more question, but I don't want to, if other people have questions, I'll kind of step back.
I have a question, but please go ahead, yes.
Okay, so this very interesting talk touched on a lot of themes, and one of them that you came back to many times is relationship between thinking and language. And I was reflecting on the people in that Amazon jungles who have language that some people call primitive or simple, but I'm not sure that that's the right word, but certainly language with a very different kind of structure. And I find it very unlikely from the little that I know about the language of Piraha people, for instance, that they would have the language that could express an inference, that could express extracting knowledge based on indirect evidence, things like that. So would you expect that by not having a language that could cover this kind of expression that they also do not have that kind of thinking?
Yeah, that's, again, these are really, really interesting questions, and they're not easy to answer. Why? Well, because if you look across languages, known languages, the one that we can better explore, the way in which you express logical, so for example, we know all and some, I mean, those who studied logic, they start from this, because in logic 101, you start from those. As a matter of fact, some of these words are not represented in all languages. Yet, this phenomena, like this upward and downward implicature that I was showing to you before, like words that behave in a particular way, like ever or never, they appear to be universal. In all the studied languages, you find these words that seem to signal that their logical behavior is important, right? So that is there. Yeah. Now, whether it's there in Piraha's language, that I don't know, but there is extremely interesting recent work on two populations. One is the one of Nicaraguan Sign Language, which is this language that was born essentially from one day to another, not exactly like that, but you know, there was this community in Nicaragua which was scattered, or people who were deaf, and they were essentially home signers, no common language. Then at a certain point, a school was made, and they were brought from their villages to that school. And there is a very detailed work that has been done across the last 20 years to find out the differences between first cohort, second cohort, third cohort, and so on, of the speakers. And it turns out that very rapidly the language gathered the grammar, okay? Uh-huh. Now, recently, people started asking, okay, how about logical parts of language? And so recently there is a work which has been done by Anne-Marie Kochab, I don't know how to pronounce her name, and Marie Coppola, Annie Sengas, which showed that even the first cohort of Nicaraguan sign language speakers, those who were just arriving from, they had signs in their own language that corresponds to words that we would express with some, all, few, many. Mm-hmm. So I would tend to say that I don't know about representing the unknown, but definitely in terms of logical representation, that's there. Not only that, but Anne-Marie Kochab also studied home signers, so people who don't even have a sign language, and she found that they have the expression representing quantifiers.
Mm-hmm.
So that suggests that at least the logical representation is there. Now, if you have these logical representations and if you have or, you can also represent A or B, therefore you can represent unknown.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But so, you, I mean, why do you say things in language? Do you say them because you think them and then, and you feel that the, so you feel that the language needs to be able to say it. And so you insert it into language because, yeah. I mean, the language is important by itself. It's created because people think something and they feel that they need to be able to say it.
Yeah, the pressure for language, I mean, again, it's a complex answer. Let me give you the simple one. My personal point of view is that the pressure for having a language comes from the fact that you have a rich thought system, mm-hmm. and therefore you have a rich language system, mm-hmm. okay? Now, language has a lot of other roles. Let me tell you one, which is very important, again, on this literature. When you look at the difference between home signers and signers of a sign language, we're talking about deaf people, mm-hmm. you do find an incredible amount of differences, which mm-hmm. do depend on the fact that there is an exchange in a community. Let me give you an anecdote, which I know was reported by Marie Coppola when she was studying these signers. No? She goes to study these home signers, and so there is the mother of the kid who is deaf and mute, so only signs. And at a certain point, so she can express a little with the signer because they know the basic of the signers. At a certain point, she starts not quarreling, but discussing with the mother of the guy. You know? And and then the guy asked, why are you talking to my mother in this way? And she said, well, because she doesn't speak my language and we don't understand exactly what we are saying because she was speaking Spanish and the other person was speaking only English. No? And the home signer was struck by the fact that there is the possibility of miscommunication among people who speak. He was struck by the fact that two persons can speak different languages.
Mm-hmm.
And also by the fact that you can have a state of knowledge which is different from person to person. The idea there is, okay, I am deaf and mute, so I really know very little, but those who speak, mm-hmm. they must have the same kind of knowledge. Why should they hide knowledge from one to the other? Why should there be a misunderstanding? So the language has an incredible role of regimenting things in a community so that you crystallize a thought into words that you can express to somebody else who can treat them and gives you back. And this is the part that you don't have if you don't have a language.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll be quiet for now.
Well, yes. Let me ask you a general question, Luca, because I'm fascinated by this topic. But prompted by the fact that there is a significant fractions of this network working in artificial intelligence, in the sense that where you were showing this experiment, beautiful experiment, I was thinking that maybe you can train some sort of machine learning. Model in which is to guide your experiment and put your because these are difficult experiments. You mentioned this children are moving around, so you can sort of run this before doing the experiment in such that you can guide the experiment in the optimal situation. But it seems that in the comment that you were making before, it seems that this is not useful, I mean, at least so.
Well, there are two different things here. One is to say, let's revert this, which is the one you're suggesting. Let's revert the process. Let's look at what kind of optimal situations are from the point of view of artificial intelligence. This gives you the optimal situation to study a thinking mm-hmm. process.
Mm-hmm.
That's a possibility. We didn't think about it. I think it's very interesting. What I'm more concerned is the opposite, which is, okay, give me, for example, a convolutional network. Run it on some kind of extremely deprived input, like networks which recognize objects visually do. You start from pixel description, right? And then find the moment in which the network is representing something as unknown, as opposed to something that is known. Because all these networks are there to identify objects in pictures, for example, right? So the identity is fundamental, but I don't think that the point of, so if you see an object with a lot of fruit, vegetables, and so on, you run your artificial intelligence network. I mean, this is what now is becoming standard, and you pull out tagging, because this is what you do. You tag parts of the of this picture as you know, this is an apple, this is a pear. Okay, I don't know of any work. It certainly have to exist. So I'm talking about ignorance that says, well, but in the world, there are an incredible amount of situations where information is never explicitly recognized. What's the mental representation or the internal representation of the network when you cannot derive the information? Is it actually able to, I mean, can you give enough data so that something appears that looks like a variable, like an unknown, which is a stable unknown? Because when you have an X that ranges over, I mean, the very basic reason of having a typified language is that you can abstract out of the domain and say, okay, this is an X, I don't know what it is. The domain, give me the domain, it ranges over this domain, for example. I don't know if anything like that has been done or is possible to be done. So the projects there are two. One is from my side to yours and saying, look, I have this data, how do you represent an unknown? And the other one is from yours to mine, which I think is very useful. We say, look, this is the optimal situation from the point of view of this kind of, say, association network, okay? It predicts that this should be extremely clear information. Can you show that it's extremely clear also in a 10-month-old infant?
Yeah, that's exactly very interesting. Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I don't see any other questions. Yes. I think, well, you know, as I mentioned, the talk was Costa Rica, really, although I'm a very different field, you know, I was completely fascinated by this topic and I really wish to continue this. My hope, in fact, is that, you know, as a Christmas lecture, we are planning to have someone from the robotic, you know, people from, there is one fellow in the network that is probably, so we should continue this discussion.
With great pleasure. And yes. If you want to come and test the kids.
Yes.
Okay, no, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for the attendance and see you next time.
Okay. Thanks. Bye-bye, Matthew. Thanks. Bye, Ale.
Grazie, Luca. Ciao.
Grazie a te.
Ciao.
Ciao.